video explains load balancer design in ACI. When we think about load balancer design, it's important to understand the desired traffic flow. For example, is that north-south or east-west design? Do you need other service devices such as firewall in front of load balancer, etc.? With regard to load balancer, these are typical items to identify the design requirements. In case of load balancer, it's most likely layer 3 routed mode and active standby HA. The important point to check are how to handle return traffic and VIP addressing. We are going to talk about them in this presentation. We are going to talk about 4 typical load balancer design options in traditional design and then explain how to translate these designs to ACI constructs. The first example is load balancer is the gateway of servers. In this case, return traffic goes through the load balancer without source NAT or PBR. The second example is router or switch is the gateway of servers, but load balancer is in the gateway of that router, so that return traffic goes through the load balancer. This design is typically called VRF sandwich. The third example is router or switch is the gateway of servers, and load balancer is not directly in the routing path. In this case, source NAT or PBR is required to make return traffic go through the load balancer. The last example is similar to third one, but the load balancer is in the same subnet with the servers. Let's take a look at how each option looks like in ACI. Option 1 is load balancer as a gateway. In this design, we have two bridge domains. One is L2 bridge domain for server and internal interface of load balancer. The other is L3 bridge domain for external interface of the load balancer. This option is pretty simple. Service graph is not mandatory. Source NAT or PBR is not required. This is network design construct. For contract design, you need two contracts. One is between external side of load balancer and external EPG. The other is between internal side of load balancer and provider EPGs. You can combine internal side of load balancer and servers to one EPG instead of having separate EPGs with contract if you don't need a filter between them. Option 2 is fabric as a gateway. In this design, we have two VRFs. One is for external, the other is for internal. And load balancer is between two VRFs. L3 bridge domain in internal VRF is for servers, and L3 bridge domain in external VRF is for external side of the load balancer. Option 3 is fabric as a gateway. In this design, we have 3 bridge domains. One is bridge domain for server segment, and the others are for load balancer. Source NAT or PBR is required to make the return traffic go back to the load balancer. If PBR is used, service graph is mandatory. The advantage of this design is that only specific traffic goes through the load balancer. For contract design, if PBR is used, one contract is in between consumer and provider EPGs. Internal service EPGs for the load balancer interfaces are created through service graph. If source NAT is used instead of PBR, service graph is not mandatory. In that case, it's going to be two contracts, same with previous examples. The last design is pretty much same with previous example, except that servers and load balancer are in the same L3 bridge domain. Source NAT or PBR is required. If PBR is used, service graph is mandatory, same with previous example. This design can be used for L2 DSR, direct server return, where the return traffic directly goes back to the client. We've been using the designs where VIP is in the same subnet with load balancer external interface. What if the VIP is not in the load balancer interface IP subnet range? If the IP is not in ACI leaf routing table, traffic is dropped. So we need to make sure ACI fabric has a route to VIP. In that case, we have three options. One is adding the VIP subnet as the secondary IP for the bridge domain. This is not always ideal, for example, if you don't have the entire subnet for the VIP. The second option is to use static route on BD, but this is only available for /32 route. This might not be ideal if you have multiple VIPs. The third option is to use L3 out for the external side of the load balancer. Here are the examples. Instead of using bridge domain for external side, using L3 out and add route to VIP by using static route or dynamic routing protocol between ACI leaf and load balancer. These are topologies using L3 out for external side of load balancer in previous examples. Let's talk about the PBR design consideration. In case of load balancer, incoming traffic doesn't require PBR because traffic is coming to VIP. Then traffic goes to provider from load balancer. Then return traffic from provider to consumer, PBR is required if source NAT is not used. This means PBR is enabled for return traffic only. In service graph device selection policy configuration, PBR should be enabled on provider side only, so that we can use PBR only for return traffic, meaning provider to consumer. Another important configuration consideration is direct connect in service graph template. By default, service graph with PBR creates permit and redirect rule for these traffics that we discussed in the previous slide. As you can see, it doesn't create a permit rule for traffic from provider EPG to provider interface of the service device. This is okay for firewall or IPS, but it's not good for load balancer because load balancer does health check to the provider. To permit this traffic, direct connect option in service graph template must be set to true, so that when service graph is deployed, permit rule for the traffic from provider EPG to provider side of load balancer is also created. We've been using load balancer only service graph, but in actual deployment, you probably have firewall or IPS in front of load balancer. Multi-node service graph with PBR is also supported up to 5 function nodes per service graph. For example, between client EPG and web EPG, the first node is IPS, the second node is firewall, and then the last node is load balancer. The last topic is DSR, direct server return, where the return traffic doesn't go through load balancer. By default, DSR doesn't work in ACI fabric because of data plane IP running. In case of DSR, servers have VIP address as loopback, but they don't respond up request to that VIP. So traffic destined to VIP arrives on load balancer, and then load balancer rewrites destination MAC to one of the MAC addresses of the servers. Then the return traffic is sent by the load balancer using VIP as a source. This causes endpoint update on ACI fabric because of data plane IP learning. Basically, this is endpoint flopping because the same IP is learned from multiple different locations. To prevent this, L4L7 virtual IP option under the EPG should be configured. By specifying IP under the particular EPG, for example, LB EPG, ACI fabric runs that specific IP only through app on that particular EPG, and it's not learned from other EPGs such as web EPGs, so that we can avoid endpoint flopping. If the service EPG is created through service graph, that option is available under device selection policy. Thank you.